From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
On this vote, the ayes are 50, the nays are 48. The nomination of Brett M. Kavanaugh of Maryland to be an Associate Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States is confirmed.
The Senate confirms Brett Kavanaugh as the 9th Supreme Court Justice. He's expected to tilt power to conservatives for decades to come. His confirmation comes despite several accusations of attempted rape and sexual assault. We'll get reaction and look at what's next.
We refuse to be intimidated by the mob of people that were coming after Republican members at their homes, in the halls. I couldn't be prouder of the Senate Republican Conference. Yeah, these things always blow over.
Now we take this anger and determination, and we realize that today is going to send a depth charge through politics as we know it, and we go home, we vote, and we run for office.
We'll go to Washington, D.C. to speak with Code Pink's Medea Benjamin about protesters at the Capitol and with Rewire editor-in-chief Jody Jacobson. We'll also speak with feminist author Saraya Chamali. Her new book, Rage Becomes Her, The Power of Women's Anger. Then fears are growing over the missing Saudi journalist Jamal Khashoggi, who Turkish officials say they believe was murdered in the Saudi consulate in Istanbul last week. Khashoggi is a Washington Post columnist. He lives in the United States and is a critic of the Saudi regime.
He is gathering all power within his hand, and it would be much better for him to allow a breathing space for critic, for Saudi intellectuals, Saudi writers, Saudi media to debate the most important needed transformation going in the country.
We'll speak with Mehdi Hassan, columnist for The Intercept, who knows Khashoggi and has interviewed him. We'll also speak with Medea Benjamin, author of Kingdom of the Unjust, Behind the U.S.-Saudi Connection. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Brett Kavanaugh was sworn in Saturday as an Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court just hours after the Senate voted to confirm him. The 53-year-old's lifetime appointment cements a right-wing majority on the court for the foreseeable future. The vote was 50 in favor, 48 against, and one present, Republican Senator Lisa Murkowski, who promised to buck her party and vote no on Kavanaugh. She voted present so that Republican Senator Steve Daines of Montana could attend his daughter's wedding without voting. Republican Senator Susan Collins of Maine, who was seen as a possible swing vote on Kavanaugh's confirmation, announced her support for the candidate Friday afternoon.
Despite the turbulent, bitter fights surrounding his nomination, my fervent hope is that Brett Kavanaugh will work to lessen the divisions in the Supreme Court so that we have far fewer 5-4 decisions and so that public confidence in our judiciary and our highest court is restored. Mr. President, I will vote to confirm Judge Kavanaugh.
Kavanaugh's confirmation came under intense public scrutiny after three women accused him of sexual misconduct. He has denied the allegations made by Dr. Christine Blasey Ford, as well as two more accusers, Julie Swetnick and Kavanaugh's former Yale classmate, Debbie Ramirez, who said he exposed himself to her during a party. In a statement released Saturday, Ramirez said by their vote, the senators were, quote, deliberately ignoring Kavanaugh's behavior, adding, I feel like I'm right back at Yale, where half the room is laughing and looking the other way. This is how victims are isolated and silenced, Ramirez said. West Virginia Senator Joe Manchin was the only Democratic senator to vote in favor of Kavanaugh's confirmation. This is Manchin after declaring his support for Kavanaugh last Friday.
Well, I'm very much concerned, basically, with the sexual abuse that people have had to endure, and very much concerned that we have to do something as a country. But I had to deal with the facts I had in front of me.
Senator, do you think that there's still a place in the Democratic Party for you after this?
I'm just a West Virginian. I'm just a good old West Virginian.
You're up for re-election.
Pro protests against Kavanaugh's confirmation raged in Washington, D.C. and across the country Saturday. Capitol Police arrested 164 demonstrators, including 150 at the U.S. Capitol building, and a handful of protesters who interrupted the Senate roll call vote. In New York City, protesters took to the streets just as Kavanaugh was confirmed. This is Zaki Ansari of the Alliance for Quality Education.
This is bigger than Kavanaugh. I want to constantly say that. This is way bigger. As a black Muslim woman in society, I am clear that Kavanaugh will not only return Roe v. Wade, but many civil rights legislations that are impactful, many things that have been supportive of communities that look like me, he will overturn those as well. But what I also am clear is that as a black woman in society, knowing that the struggles that we've been up against, that we, too, can rise above this. We, too, can fight back.
We'll have more on the confirmation of Brett Kavanaugh to the Supreme Court after headlines. The United Nations Climate Panel warns in a new report humanity has only a dozen years to mitigate climate change or face global catastrophe, with severe droughts, floods, sea level rise and extreme heat set to cause mass displacement and poverty. The landmark report by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the IPCC, warns dramatic action is needed over the next 12 years to hold global temperature rise below 1.5 degrees Celsius or 2.7 degrees Fahrenheit, beyond which global crises could unfold at a rapid pace. The report comes as Governor Rick Scott has declared Florida a state of emergency, as forecasters predict Tropical Storm Michael could strengthen to become a major hurricane as it makes landfall late Wednesday. In Indonesia, the death toll from last month's massive earthquake and tsunami has risen to more than 1,900, with some 60,000 people displaced after an 18-foot wall of water swept miles into the island of Sulawesi. Authorities warn some 5,000 people remain missing, many of them likely swept out to sea or trapped amidst rubble that could take months or years to clear. In Haiti, at least 12 people died and nearly 200 were injured after a 5-foot-9 magnitude earthquake struck Saturday evening in Haiti's northwest. Many of the injuries came as unsafe cinder block homes and structures collapsed on residents. In Brazil, far-right presidential candidate Jair Bolsonaro surged to first place in Sunday's general election, but will face an October 28th runoff election after narrowly missing an outright win. Bolsonaro claimed 46% of the vote. He'll face Workers' Party candidate Fernando Haddad, who won just under 30%. Bolsonaro had a history of making racist, misogynistic and homophobic comments. He is a former army officer who's openly praised Brazil's military dictatorship of the late 1960s and has encouraged police to kill suspected drug dealers and once told a female lawmaker she was too ugly to rape. Ahead of the election, anti-Bolsonaro protesters rallied in Sao Paulo and in other cities Saturday proclaiming, "Not him."
My son is transgender, and for his security, I am protesting. Bolsonaro is homophobic and incites violence against those who are not heterosexual.
Fears are growing over the fate of missing Saudi journalist Jamal Khashoggi, after Turkish officials said they believe he was murdered in the Saudi consulate in Istanbul last Tuesday. Khashoggi is a columnist for The Washington Post. He'd been living in self-imposed exile in the United States. He entered the Saudi consulate in Istanbul, Turkey, seeking a document he needed to get married. He's not been seen since. The Washington Post reports a Turkish investigation has revealed a group of about 15 Saudi men traveled to Istanbul to kill him as he visited the consulate. Saudi officials have denied the report and say they don't know Khashoggi's whereabouts. Democratic Senator Chris Murphy of Connecticut tweeted Sunday, "If this is true, that the Saudis lured a U.S. resident into their consulate and murdered him, it should represent a fundamental break in our relationship with Saudi Arabia," he said. We'll have more on the story later in the broadcast. In Afghanistan, at least 54 people were killed across the country on Sunday, on the 17th anniversary of the start of the U.S. invasion. The death toll in Afghanistan included at least 19 Afghan civilians. American and Afghan airstrikes have increased in recent months as the conflict shows no sign of slowing down and the Taliban remain undefeated. The United Nations says the number of civilians killed in Afghanistan reached a record high in the first half of the year, with some 1,700 deaths reported. In New York, protesters gathered Sunday to call for an end to the Afghan war, the longest war in U.S. history. This is Susan Schnall of Veterans for Peace.
It's about all the wars that the United States perpetrates on other countries, and the fact that what I have seen over the past 50 years is United States multinational corporations getting larger and larger and continuing to support an American military that feels it can change the governance of any country it wishes to in furtherance of the interests of the corporations.
In the Gaza Strip, Israeli forces shot dead three Palestinians and injured 126 Friday during weekly protests near Israel's separation barrier. Among the dead was a 12-year-old boy, Faris al-Sarsawi. Israeli gunfire has killed at least 195 Palestinians and has wounded some 18,000 since Palestinians' Great March of Return protests began March 30th. In the West Bank, Israeli police say a 23-year-old Palestinian man shot and killed two Israelis and injured a third person at an industrial park near an Israeli settlement Sunday. Meanwhile, the wife of Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu appeared in a Jerusalem courtroom Sunday, facing trial on charges of fraud and breach of trust. Sarah Netanyahu is accused of spending about $100,000 to hire celebrity chefs to prepare meals for the Netanyahus and their guests, even though the prime minister's residence has a full-time chef. The trial comes as prosecutors have recommended indictments against Prime Minister Netanyahu for accepting bribes and trading political favors for positive news coverage. In Bulgaria, police found the body of a 30-year-old journalist Saturday in the northern town of Rus after she disappeared shortly after reporting on alleged corruption by local authorities. Police say Victoria Maranova's body showed signs she'd been raped, bludgeoned to the head and suffocated. She's the third journalist murdered in the European Union over the past year. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo says North Korea will let international inspectors into nuclear sites and missile testing facilities. Pompeo's comments came after he wrapped up talks with leader Kim Jong-un in Pyongyang on Sunday. In western Germany, more than 50,000 protesters converged on the Hambach Forest Saturday, demanding an end to the planned expansion of a neighboring open-pit coal mine, the largest in Europe. The protests came as a German court halted plans by the RWE energy company to clear-cut more of the forest to make way for expanded mining. The court says it needs more time to determine whether the plans violate European Union environmental laws, a decision that won't happen until at least 2020. Last month, police raided a protest encampment in the Hambach Forest, arresting dozens of activists who'd been living in tree houses. To see our report from the Hambach Forest, you can go to democracynow.org. In Chicago, a jury Friday found white police officer Jason Van Dyke guilty of second-degree murder for killing African-American teenager Laquan McDonald in 2014. Van Dyke was also found guilty on 16 counts of aggravated battery, one count for each of the 16 bullets he fired at McDonald. A key piece of evidence for prosecutors was a police dash cam video showing McDonald posed no threat walking away from officers before Van Dyke fired at him, emptying an entire magazine from his handgun. Jason Van Dyke was the first Chicago cop to stand trial for an on-duty murder in 50 years. In Charlotte, North Carolina, NFL star Eric Reed, who helped spark league-wide protests in 2016 when he became the first player to kneel alongside Colin Kaepernick during the playing of the national anthem, took a knee ahead of his first game with the Carolina Panthers Sunday. Reed's protests against police brutality and racial injustice came after he spent the offseason as an unsigned free agent before he was finally picked up by the Panthers late last month. Both Reed and Kaepernick have filed grievances with the NFL, alleging owners conspired to deny them contracts over their protests. Kaepernick is still unsigned. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Brett Kavanaugh was sworn in Saturday as an Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court, just hours after the Senate voted to confirm him amidst massive protests outside the Capitol. Kavanaugh will begin hearing cases Tuesday and could vote as early as Tuesday or Wednesday on a case that tests how much power courts would wield over the executive branch. His nomination came under intense public scrutiny after accusations of attempted rape and sexual assault surfaced. One of his accusers, Dr. Christine Blasey Ford, testified in front of the Senate Judiciary Committee about Kavanaugh's alleged rape attempt when she was 15 and he 17. Attorney Deborah Katz told MSNBC Dr. Blasey Ford is still living in hiding after her testimony.
This has been terrifying. Her family has been through a lot. They are not living at home. It's going to be quite some time before they're able to live at home. The threats have been unending. It's deplorable. It's been very frightening. And she's also received extraordinary letters of support and encouragement. But these threats are extremely distressing.
Brett Kavanaugh's denied allegations of sexual assault made by Dr. Blasey Ford, as well as two more women, Julie Swetnick and his former Yale classmate, Deborah Ramirez, who said Kavanaugh exposed himself to her during a party. In a statement released Saturday, Ramirez said that by their vote, the senators were, quote, deliberately ignoring Kavanaugh's behavior, adding, quote, I feel like I'm right back at Yale, where half the room is laughing and looking the other way. This is how victims are isolated and silenced, Ramirez said. The Senate voted Saturday to confirm Kavanaugh's lifetime appointment to the nation's highest court by a vote of 50 to 48. Lisa Murkowski of Alaska was the lone Republican to oppose Kavanaugh's nomination. She voted present so that Republican Senator Steve Daines of Montana could attend his daughter's wedding without voting. Senator Joe Manchin of West Virginia was the only Democrat to break ranks and back the judge. Vice President Pence was in the Senate gallery to oversee the vote as protesters shouted their opposition.
Sergeant at Arms will restore order in the gallery. Is there a sufficient second? There is a sufficient second. The clerk will call the roll.
Mr. Alexander.
The sergeant at arms will restore order in the gallery. The sergeant at arms will restore order in the gallery.
Saturday's vote came after Republican Senator Susan Collins of Maine announced Friday, after weeks of suspense, she would vote to confirm.
Despite the turbulent, bitter fights surrounding his nomination, my fervent hope is that Brett Kavanaugh will work to lessen the divisions in the Supreme Court so that we have far fewer 5-4 decisions, and so that public confidence in our judiciary and our highest court is restored. Mr. President, I will vote to confirm Judge Kavanaugh.
During Collins' speech, so many users logged onto a crowdfunding website to raise $4 million to support her opponent in Maine that it crashed. Meanwhile, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell said Sunday on Fox the vote could help Republicans in November.
We stood up for the presumption of innocence. We refused to be intimidated by the mob of people that were coming after Republican members at their homes, in the halls. These things always blow over. Our base is fired up. We finally discovered the one thing that would fire up the Republican base, and we didn't think of it. The other side did it.
Senate Majority Leader McConnell also said he was prepared to take up another nomination to the Supreme Court by President Trump in 2020. Even though he blocked President Obama's nomination of Merrick Garland to the Supreme Court in 2016 because it was an election year. This comes as President Trump is already touting Kavanaugh's appointment to the Supreme Court as a major victory. Speaking Saturday at a rally in Topeka, Kansas, he urged voters to support Republican candidates, saying Democrats had become, quote, too extreme and too dangerous to govern.
You don't hand matches to an arsonist, and you don't give power to an angry left-wing mob, and that's what they've become.
For more, we're joined by three guests in Washington, D.C. Medea Benjamin, co-founder of Code Pink, was part of the protests in front of the Supreme Court Saturday against Kavanaugh's confirmation. Also with us, Jody Jacobson, president and editor-in-chief of Rewire. She wrote a piece this weekend headlined A Titanic Fraud. Susan Collins, the moderate, who never was. And Soraya Chamale, longtime writer and feminist activist and author of the new book Rage Becomes Her, The Power of Women's Anger. She's also director of the Women's Media Center Speech Project and organizer of the Safety and Free Speech Coalition. We welcome you all back to Democracy Now! So that moment at 3 o'clock on Friday, when Susan Collins announced that she would vote to confirm Judge Kavanaugh as the next Supreme Court Justice of the United States, Jody Jacobson, that's what you focused on in your column. Talk about the significance of this. Of course, Senator Murkowski of Alaska announced she would not support Judge Kavanaugh. In the end, she simply voted present to balance out her colleague, Senator Daines, who went home to his daughter's wedding. Senator Collins, Jody, why do you call her a fraud?
Well, Senator Collins has often been portrayed as a moderate, but that portrayal is really an inside the beltway portrayal. It's a convenient tool for media pundits to use in order to have someone on the Republican side they can use to frame off with Joe Manchin, for example. But Susan Collins is not a moderate. She has voted with Mitch McConnell and with now President Trump most of the time. She has taken a step here. It's really beyond just a vote. She went on the floor of the Senate to literally gaslight the entire nation about both the process and about the nominee himself. She took Republican talking points about the process of the FBI investigation, for example, which was far from complete and far from thorough and did not even include an interview with either Brett Kavanaugh or Dr. Blasey Ford, and called it a complete investigation. It didn't have—there were many, many witnesses that were not called and many leads that were not followed. It was really the epitome of window dressing. So she tried to tell us that a full investigation had been carried out, that she had, examined his record and found it to be far more centrist or liberal than other people, mostly all of us, have deigned it to be, or have read it to be, rather. And then also, she then went on to tell Dr. Blasey Ford that she did not know what she was talking about. And there's this Republican line that goes, well, we believe Dr. Blasey Ford, but we don't think she really knows what happened to her. And if that is not the definition of trying to gaslight someone, I don't know what is. It was deeply, deeply painful, really. I mean that personally.
I mean, I want to turn to turn to the fact that neither Blasey Ford or Kavanaugh was interviewed by the FBI, a very different situation than being questioned at the Senate Judiciary Committee. This is what Dr. Blasey Ford had called for, an FBI investigation. The criticism at the beginning, once it was going forward, is don't just interview the two of them, go beyond that. But I think very few people thought, maybe Mitch McConnell did, that the two of them weren't going to be interviewed. And it's particularly significant when it comes to Brett Kavanaugh, because he would be under oath. It wouldn't be the Democrats asking questions and he could attack them for being Democrat and then the Republicans simply supporting him. He would having to directly answer FBI questions. Can you explain how it was possible that the FBI investigation didn't include interviews with these two primary people?
Was controlled by the White House in conjunction with the Republican side of the Senate Judiciary Committee. And they decided together what would happen in the investigation. And literally, there were people that the FBI was not allowed to interview. And among those were Kavanaugh and Dr. Blasey Ford. Mm. So you have a situation where Kavanaugh, who lied under oath numerous times outside the scope of this issue of the sexual assault, but on many other issues was not being put under oath by the FBI. And if you watched the hearing, when he was questioned repeatedly, I think it was by Dick Durbin and several others, would you call for an FBI investigation? He remained silent. So he clearly did not want to be put under oath, and he did not want other people to be interviewed. And let's face it, he spent the better part of the 2 weeks before the FBI investigation in the White House with Don McGahn. So there's no way there was going to be a fair and thorough FBI investigation because he was part of the group calling the shots. I think the key thing here to realize is if you wanted justice and if you wanted to really understand if Dr. Blasey Ford had merit and credibility and her claims were credible, then you would want to do a thorough investigation and you would want to remove any question. But the reality we have to grapple with is they did not care and they did not want to understand. And that is what's so...
Well, clearly they deeply cared about putting him on the Supreme Court. I wanted to bring in Democratic Senator Elizabeth Warren, who spoke on Thursday making a new claim about the contents of the FBI documents on Kavanaugh that were reviewed by senators in the Senate basement, one after another, not being able to bring in a pen, not being able to take any notes. This is what she said.
Senators have been muzzled. So I will now say three things that committee staff has explained are permissible to say without violating committee rules, statements that I have also independently verified as accurate. One, this was not a full and fair investigation. It was sharply limited in scope and did not explore the relevant confirming facts. Two, the available documents do not exonerate Mr. Kavanaugh. And three, the available documents contradict statements Mr. Kavanaugh made under oath.
So that's Senator Warren. And this is extremely significant, Jody, because people don't know what were in those documents that these senators reviewed. And she's saying they were not exonerating.
Right. Because I think it was very critical for her to say that clearly and loudly, because what you've got is spin on the other side of the aisle saying, well, these documents show that, you know, there was no evidence for Dr. Blasey Ford's claims. And if you know what it's like to be gaslighted when you've been attacked, and I do, it's the most dehumanizing kind of experience to have something happen to you, to try to press for help and to have people dismiss you. I can't tell you how the collective pain of this episode has touched so many women, not only, of course, the women who were there throughout the 2 weeks protesting at the Capitol, giving their all, but women throughout this country who have been in this situation and have been gaslighted about it. And so it's really deeply painful.
Jody Jacobson, president and editor of Rewire.news, wrote a piece this weekend headlined "A Titanic Fraud, Susan Collins, the Moderate Who Never Was." A crowdfunding website was set up after she said she was voting for Brett Kavanaugh. $4 million was immediately raised for whoever her opponent will be in Maine. Among the names that were bandied about was Susan Rice and Cecile Richards. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. We'll be back with reaction in the streets and in the Senate chamber in a moment.
The coat of swings is just about ready to do that thing. I don't want no tears, I don't want no lies. Above all, I don't want no alibis. This judge is hip, and that ain't all. He'll give you time if you're big or small. Fall in line, or this coat is neat. Peace, brother.
Whoa, here come the judge. Here come the judge. Everybody know that he is the judge.
Because I am the judge.
He is the judge. He is the judge. Everybody knows.
Here comes the judge by Pigmeat Markham. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman. Brett Kavanaugh was sworn in Saturday as the 9th Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court, just hours after the Senate voted to confirm him amidst massive protests outside the Capitol that have been going on for weeks, inside and outside. As we continue with our guests, we are joined by Soraya Chamali, who is author of a brand-new book called Rage Becomes Her, The Power of Women's Anger, and Medea Benjamin, who was out on Saturday outside the U.S. Supreme Court, the Capitol. People were protesting inside and out. Describe the scene for us, Medea.
Well, it was an extraordinary outpouring of rage, and people were just flooding the Supreme Court steps, the Capitol, people getting arrested in civil disobedience, an extremely diverse crowd, majority women, but men as well, young people with their babies in strollers, older people, diverse in racial composition. It was quite extraordinary. And I think while we knew that Donald Trump was going to put somebody into the Supreme Court who was anti-choice, pro-corporate, pro-executive power, at least with this nomination, we've raised the Me Too movement to another level. We have thousands and thousands of new activists and hopefully millions of people who will be fired up to go to the polls in November.
Your response to the confirmation of justice now, Kavanaugh, who will begin tomorrow, the day after this national holiday?
It's an outrage. It's an outrage because of the people who voted for him not listening to Dr. Ford. It's an outrage because of the way that he reacted during the hearing should have totally disqualified him, the sarcasm, the nastiness, the disrespect. I just hope that we really do have a movement, that people don't forget this moment, because he's 53 years old. He's going to be on this court for decades to come, doing rulings that are against the interests of us, whether it's on voting rights issues, immigrant rights, women's issues, corporate issues, all of these issues. So we need a movement that goes to the polls but organizes outside the electoral sphere as well, and that's the only way we're going to counter this appointment. Mm.
Soraya Chamali, you've been traveling the country with your new book, Rage Becomes Her, The Power of Women's Anger. I don't know if it could have been timed any better. But talk about the response around the country and what has happened at this time.
I think it's clear that women on the left are galvanized by what's happening, men as well, but the momentum is really coming from women, as we've seen over and over again during these protests. On the right, actually, there's a similar anger. I would say it's the anger of resentment. It's really looking backwards as opposed to looking forwards, so it's a different sensibility. But clearly, women who were maybe complacent before, who were willing to let things slide a little bit, are no longer doing that. I think they're fed up. I think they're scared. I think they're worried. And they're interested in holding people accountable in a way that maybe wasn't true even several years ago.
I want to turn to Mitch McConnell, the Senate Majority Leader, speaking Saturday about the impact of Kavanaugh's confirmation on the upcoming midterm elections.
The tactics that have been employed both by Judiciary Committee Democratic senators and by the virtual mob that's assaulted all of us in the course of this process has turned our base on fire. They managed to deliver the only thing we had not been able to figure out how to do, which was to get our folks fired up. The other side is obviously fired up. They have been all year.
He talked about the mob. Medea Benjamin, describe what you saw outside.
Well, it's not just what I saw outside, Amy. It's what's been happening the last several weeks, particularly inside the offices of the senators. It's been extraordinary having people come, hundreds of them from around the country. Alone in Murkowski's office, the people who came from Alaska, the people who came from Maine, pouring their hearts out. I've never seen so much emotion, the tears, the love. For the people who've been telling their stories, sometimes for the first times in in their lives opening up like this. So to call us a mob is such a level of disrespect. There is a new movement in this country that the Me Too movement has gone further and deeper and now giving voice to people who just feel that they need to be heard. And the fact that they demanded that their senators listen to them, whether it was in the elevators, in the hallways, in the halls, or the kind of speak-outs that were happening outdoors as well. This is unprecedented, and I hope that it is deep enough that it is forming a strong, cohesive movement among people that will resonate through this country and change the culture of our country, the way that young people are brought up, the way that parents teach their children to respect and respect for women and men. So hopefully this will have a real cultural shift.
This is Me Too founder Tarana Burke speaking on NBC's Meet the Press Sunday.
We have set a precedent in this country of not believing, of thinking that women in particular are lying when they come forward with these allegations, when people come forward with these allegations. So the mantra, believe survivors, is about, can we start with the premise that people do not often lie about the pain and the trauma of sexual violence? If we start with that premise, that if you believe that it's true, then you can have an investigation. You can have an interrogation of the facts and that kind of thing. This is not to say believe people blanket and don't investigate and don't do anything else besides believe them. Hmm.
Soraya Chamale, can you respond to Tarana Burke, who in 2006 coined that term, Me Too, that Alyssa Milano, the actress, then picked up? On that day that the Harvey Weinstein article was first written about him attacking so many women and went to sleep, and the response to her saying, if something's happened to you, please respond with Me Too. And she was just inundated.
Yes. I mean, I think that it's very clear that while people are talking about the presumption of innocence— they're not talking about the presumption of innocence for survivors and people who have been assaulted. And, you know, you can't say that Dr. Christine Blasey Ford was confused or lying unless you presume that she is guilty of lying or not knowing what she's talking about. And the whole sham of the investigation and the course of this confirmation, I think, attests to the real fear with Me Too, which is not, as the president said, that women will lie and destroy the lives of men, but that women are telling the truth. And if women are telling the truth, then it's not just an indictment of a few bad apples, but an indictment of the entire system, an indictment of the treatment of survivors and of women by men with power, particularly on the right. And so this idea that people are lying, which is absurd on the face of it, because no one has anything to gain, ultimately, by coming forward with these stories. I mean, look at the outcome of this. Dr. Ford is hiding because of violent threats, and Brett Kavanaugh is about to become a Supreme Court justice.
Oh, yes.
So, you know, I mean, never again should anybody hear that this is ruining a man's life, that boys are in danger. And in this case, obviously, it's young white boys. Because that's really the only way you could interpret what the president said.
You write in your book, Soraya, that rage is hard for women to express. And I was wondering if you can talk about that and also Senator McConnell's characterization of the mobs.
Well, you know, I think that it's useful for McConnell to talk about a mob. These are citizens. They're articulating their needs and they're defending their rights. They happen mainly to be women, which means that they're associated with unhinged emotion. And you can see that in multiple forms of commentary coming from his party. But I think that we all understand, certainly as women, that anger and the expression of anger comes with penalties for women. We're socialized to put others first, to restrain our expressions of negative emotions because it causes discomfort. And even as little girls are rewarded for being nice and pleasing, not for being assertive or aggressive, neither of which implies that we're angry, by the way. It's just that the assertiveness and aggression and anger are not separated in the behavior and responses to girls and women. So I think that what we're seeing now in this explosion of women's feeling is clearly a pent-up need to be listened to and believed. It's a demand that this stop, that the gaslighting stop, that the doubting stop, and that the disregard for our rights as citizens come to an end.
You wrote about Kavanaugh's rage versus Blasey Ford in the testimony.
Yes. Well, she was so composed and demure, and actually, she was deferential, right? She went out of her way to try and put others at ease, which I think is fairly common for women in her situation, certainly knowing that—and she not only was a witness, but an expert witness. Right? She was testifying, but she also has studied this her entire life. She knows what these dynamics look like. I would say that the saddest part, actually, of her whole testimony to me was when she used the word collegiality, because it showed that she really considered that these people that she was appealing to, and on the right, of course, it was all men, three of whom had been participants in the Anita Hill Judge Clarence Thomas hearings, that they considered her a peer, that they would treat her with mutual respect, that they would acknowledge her professional expertise. And that is simply not true. She could not make that assumption. And that comes as a rude shock to girls and women all the time, that we believe that we are functioning as equals with equal dignity and with the knowledge that we have accrued some expertise. And then we're sort of slapped in the face with the information that our male peers do not feel that way at all. Kavanaugh, on the other hand, came in roaring and indignant and petulant, and his emotionality overwhelmed everything else in the room. And he could do that because in our culture there is an essential core of rationality that is associated with being a man. It actually didn't degrade the idea that he could think clearly. Whereas if you're a woman, you don't have that assumption. People don't presume that about you. You are all emotionality, and if by chance you think clearly, that's sort of a layered on top of this feelings orientation that we're supposed to naturally have as women, which is of course nonsense. Men are no more rational or logical than women are, and women are no more unhinged and emotional than men. That was very clear from the confirmation hearings.
So a lot of the discussion has been about the midterm elections, and this has galvanized the right, many Republicans are saying. Interestingly, shortly after Kavanaugh was confirmed to the Supreme Court, Republican Congressman Steve King tweeted a photo of a sleeping infant and said, quote, "Soon babies like this little angel will be protected in the womb by law," of course, referring to the overturning of Roe v. Wade. As we wrap up, since you've just come from this book tour around the country, how people are continuing to organize, or do you think this stops women in their tracks?
Oh, gosh, no. I mean, very clearly, I think that maybe one of the most formidable confrontations of what we have been living with is about to come. I think that this is not stopping anything in its tracks. If we're looking at a 12-hour clock, we're probably at second three or four, I would say. I mean, the truth is that a lot of people would like Me Too and any suggestions that Me Too has failed or come to an end to go away. And it's really not an end. It's a beginning. This is not a movement that is about to come to a close or that it's looking back. It really is an incredibly sustained and committed challenge to these systemic abuses.
Soraya Chomali, we want to thank you for being with us. Rage Becomes Her, The Power of Women's Anger is Soraya's new book. Medea Benjamin, we're asking you to stay with us as we turn to a very different story right now. What has happened to Jamal Khashoggi? He walks into the Saudi consulate in Istanbul, Turkey. He's a columnist for The Washington Post. And he never comes out, as far as anyone knows. He's believed to be dead. What happened? Stay with us.
You can't blame the youth. You can't fool the youth. You
You can't blame the youth of today. You can't fool the youth. You're teaching youths to learn in school. That cow jump over moon. You're teaching youths to learn in school. That the dish run away with spoon. So you can't blame the youth
when they don't learn.
You can't fool, the youth. You can't blame the youth
of today.
You can't fool the youth. You teach the youth about Christopher Columbus, and you said he was a very great man. You teach the youth about Marco Polo, and you said he was a very great man. You teach the youth about the pirate Hawkins, and you said he was a very great man. You teach the youth about the pirate Morgan, and you said he was a very great man.
Can't Blame the Youth by Peter Tosh. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. Fears are growing over the fate of missing Saudi journalist Jamal Khashoggi, who Turkish officials say they believe was murdered in the Saudi consulate in Istanbul, Turkey, last week. Khashoggi was a columnist for The Washington Post. He's been living in self-imposed exile in the United States. He entered the Saudi consulate in Turkey seeking a document he needed to get married and has not been seen since. The Washington Post reports a Turkish investigation has revealed a group of about 15 Saudi men traveled to Istanbul to kill Khashoggi as he visited the consulate. Saudi officials have denied the report and say they don't know the journalist's whereabouts. In an interview with Bloomberg last week, the Saudi crown prince, Mohammed bin Salman, said the Saudis were very keen to know what happened to Khashoggi and would allow Turkish officials to enter the Saudi consulate and search the premises. But when he was pressed about whether Khashoggi faces charges in Saudi Arabia, he evaded the question. Khashoggi is a well-known critic of the Saudi regime. Democratic Senator Chris Murphy of Connecticut tweeted Sunday, "If this is true, that the Saudis lured a U.S. resident into their consulate and murdered him, it should represent a fundamental break in our relationship with Saudi Arabia," unquote. Well, last week, the Washington Post printed a blank column in support of Khashoggi. It was titled, "A Missing Vote," with just his byline. "A Missing Voice," it was the headline. Our next guest is Mehdi Hassan, who interviewed Jamal Khashoggi in Washington, D.C. earlier this year.
Your crown prince to Putin, to Iran's supreme leader. You've said he's creating, quote, an interesting form of dictatorship. How so?
I still see him as a reformer, but he is gathering all power within his hand. And it would be much better for him to allow a breathing space for critic, for Saudi intellectuals, Saudi writers, Saudi media to debate the most important needed transformation going in the country. What he is doing, I called for, and I got fired for when I was an editor of a newspaper, allowing women to drive or for women to be empowered or to limit the power of the religious establishment. I demanded that, and he is doing the right things. But it is an important transformation that requires all of us to contribute to it, to discuss it, and no one should be jailed.
We go now to Washington, D.C., where we are joined by Mehdi Hassan, who is interviewing Jamal Khashoggi. Mehdi is a columnist for The Intercept, host of their Deconstructed podcast. He is the host of Upfront at Al Jazeera English, where Jamal was speaking. Also with us, Medea Benjamin, co-founder of Code Pink, who knew Khashoggi and is the author of Kingdom of the Unjust, Behind the U.S.-Saudi Connection. We welcome you both to Democracy Now! Mehdi, talk about the latest news and what we understand at this point has happened to Jamal Khashoggi.
So over the weekend, Amy, we had Turkish government officials and police officers and advisors to Erdogan, the president, leaking and, you know, stating to the media that this Saudi kill team, this assassination team, came from Saudi Arabia, 15 of them allegedly, to the consulate where Jamal Khashoggi entered last Tuesday to get this documentation for his marriage with his fiancée waiting outside, and allegedly killed him inside the consulate. There's reports that his body may have been cut up and taken out of the embassy in boxes in a car. It's horrific stuff that we're hearing about. The Saudis deny all of this, of course, although their denial isn't worth much. And interestingly, the consulate took a group of, I think, Reuters journalists over the weekend around the consulate, the sixth floor, opening the doors of closets very ostentatiously to show that he's not in the building. He's not here. He left. And yet, funnily enough, their CCTV wasn't working, apparently, the day he came in. So they've got no video footage of him leaving. How convenient, Amy. I mean, look, the Saudis are involved involved in the disappearance of Jamal Khashoggi. If, God forbid, he's dead, as is looking very likely, it's been several days now with no proof of life. This is a horrific escalation in the Crown Prince's campaign to silence dissent, to silence any criticism, even the mildest of criticism, from Saudis at home or abroad. It's deeply worrying, deeply concerning, and the world shouldn't sit silently by, although I suspect they will.
Mehdi Hassan, talk about who Jamal Khashoggi, I don't even know whether to say, is or was.
Yeah. He was one of the most prominent Saudi voices, journalists. Everyone in the Western media knew him. He was an access point for the Saudi royal family for a long time. He was an advisor to Saudi royals like Turki bin Faisal, who was ambassador to the U.S., former Saudi intelligence chief. He was advisor to Walid bin Talal, a very prominent, wealthy Saudi businessman and prince. He had appeared on many TV shows, not just mine, was well-known here in Washington, D.C., where he moved in 2017 when he felt that the new crown prince, Mohammed bin Salman, MBS, wasn't letting him speak freely on Twitter, wasn't letting him write articles. And he wasn't an opposition figure. People are calling him a dissident. He wasn't a dissident. He supported Saudi Arabia. He supported the Saudi royal family. What he didn't like was MBS's autocracy, even by the standards of autocratic Saudi rulers. And he said it on my show. He said, look, I'm not calling for elections. I'm just saying, let me write some pieces. Let me be a journalist. Let people in Saudi Arabia say what they want to say, even if they're, you know, mildly critical. And it just goes to show how thin-skinned MBS is, that someone like Jamal Khashoggi, who is a member of the Saudi establishment, is not calling for elections, is just saying, let's have some better reforms. Let's all be part of this reform project that you claim to be leading. If even he's seen as a threat, and if even he's seen as someone who can be taken out, assassinated, extrajudicially killed in a foreign country, what does that say about, A, MBS and how thin-skinned he is, how intolerant he is? And, B, what does that say for Saudis around the world who want to be critical of their country? What does that say about journalists now? We live in a year, Amy, where journalists are being killed in astonishing numbers. A Bulgarian journalist brutally murdered and raped over the weekend. And that's why people need to say something about this. But, you know, we know, Amy, you and I have discussed on this show, the Saudis get a pass. And MBS is now behaving like Colonel Gaddafi. And he'll still get a pass.
And, of course, MBS, Mohammed bin Salman, very close to Jared Kushner, the son-in-law and senior advisor to President Trump. Has the White House said anything about what has happened right now to Jamal Khashoggi?
They're saying that they're following the story, which is their way of saying we don't really want to say anything. Trump and Kushner are very close to MBS. They backed him from the very beginning as he took out rival members of his family and took basically control of that kingdom. Trump was saying last week how much he loved the Saudi king. He just wanted them to pay more for their defense because they relied on the U.S. They're not going to say anything. Look, the Canadians, Amy, a few weeks ago put out a mild tweet criticizing the detention of women's rights activists in Saudi Arabia. The Saudis, who can't handle any criticism, went crazy and chucked out the Canadian ambassador, launched an online campaign attacking Canada. And where was the rest of the world? Where was the U.S. when these two allies were having a row? They basically said, we're staying out of it. And I suspect if the Turkish government, who have their own problems with Saudi Arabia, escalate this matter and start making more public accusations about Saudi's role in the killing of a Saudi citizen on Turkish soil, then I suspect the Americans will try and stay out of it as well, because they don't want to upset the Saudis.
Last week, President Trump praised Saudi Arabia and its ruler, King Salman, but said the monarchy would quickly collapse without U.S. support. Trump was speaking Tuesday at a campaign rally in Mississippi.
We protect Saudi Arabia. Would you say they're rich? And I love the king, King Salman, but I said, King, we're protecting you. You might not be there for 2 weeks without us. You have to pay for your military. You have to pay.
So that was President Trump speaking in Mississippi. I want to bring Medea Benjamin in, co-founder of Code Pink, author of Kingdom of the Unjust, Behind the U.S.-Saudi Connection. You also knew Jamal Khashoggi. Can you talk about what's happened to him and what's happening with the U.S.-Saudi relationship?
We don't know what happened to him, but if indeed it turns out that he was murdered inside the Saudi consulate, this has to be a turning point. He is somebody who worked in the United States, a resident of the United States, worked for The Washington Post. He is a well-known journalist, a mild critic, part of the loyal opposition. If they could do this to him, it's outrageous. And I think it has to be put in the context that the Saudi, the Crown Prince, MBS, is out of control. what he is doing in Yemen, the bombing of school children, the kidnapping of Hariri in Lebanon, the throwing in prison of women activists, of scholars. He is creating an economic war with Qatar. He'd like to see the U.S. go to war with Iran. He is out of control. And at some point, we've got to break relations with Saudi. It's just all so much of this is about weapons sales. And we've got to say that the weapons companies can't control our policy. I was heartened to see over the weekend some tweets, not just by people like Chris Murphy, who's been good on this issue, but also by Marco Rubio. We need our senators, our congresspeople to say enough is enough. If indeed this is true, there have to be severe consequences, sanctions against the Saudis, and it has to be the beginning of a break in our relationship with Saudi Arabia.
Reuters reported this morning Turkey has asked for permission to search Saudi Arabia's consulate in Istanbul after the Saudi journalist Jamal Khashoggi went missing last week. Jamal Khashoggi's fiancé, his Turkish fiancé, Hatice Cengiz, the reason he went into the embassy, accompanied him to the Saudi consulate in Istanbul. She waited for him outside until after midnight, returning on Wednesday morning. She tweeted Saturday she wouldn't believe anything until she receives official confirmation, writing, Jamal was not killed, and I do not believe he was killed. Now, the Turkish authorities say they see from closed circuit around, it's a very busy area, around the consulate, they see that he went in. They don't see him coming out, Medea.
Well, it certainly seems like he was killed inside the embassy. 15 people, the consulate, 15 people came in. The Turks know they flew in. They flew right out afterwards. They have footage of these 15 people. They have footage of the cars. They are going to be making statements very soon. It is—I mean, we need to get the facts out. But I think after all of these days, we can recognize that the Saudis have brought in a hit team to get rid of a critic, again, a mild critic. And as Hassan Mehdi said, what does this mean to journalists? What does this mean to Saudis who are living in exile? What does this mean to Saudis who are living here in the United States? They are full of fear. I have friends here. They are afraid for their lives. So something has to be done to get at the truth, but also of something about accountability and U.S.-Saudi relations.
Mehdi Hassan, I wanted to ask you about Senator Murphy's tweet. Again, he says, if this is true, that the Saudis lured a U.S. resident into their consulate and murdered him, it should represent a fundamental break in our relationship with Saudi Arabia. Your final response also about what he last said to you.
Well, I'm glad Senator Murphy said that. I interviewed him recently in my podcast, and he wasn't willing to say that Saudi Arabia wasn't an ally in the way that Bernie Sanders has, for example. But I think, you know, the direction is shifting. Medea's right to mention Marco Rubio as well. But, you know, what are the liberals going to say? It's not very easy to blame Trump, where, you know, MBS came to America and was feted and met with Bezos, the owner of the Washington Post, met, you know, Zuckerberg and Bill Gates, and all these people were falling over to meet him. You know, Dwayne The Rock Johnson. Are any of them going to say anything now about this? I mean, my heart goes out to his fiance. Say it's horrible news. And when I last saw Jamal, we were joking in the green room at Al Jazeera about, you know, his personal security, MBS being in town. Did he feel safe? But here's a person who wrote in his columns for The Washington Post that, you know, I have a voice that people in Saudi Arabia don't have, and I'm going to use it. And he did at great personal risk. He knew the risks, but I don't think even he thought this would happen last week when he went into the consulate. But, you know, if the Saudis have murdered a Washington Post columnist on foreign soil and the United States government and United States media stays quiet, I think that will be just astonishing.
Well, I want to thank you both for being with us to talk about this. The Washington Post, of course, also calling this an attack on journalism, demanding answers for their columnist. We will continue to follow the case of Jamal Khashoggi. Medea Benjamin and Mehdi Hassan, thanks so much for joining us. That does it for our broadcast. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks for joining us.